is always Good Shepherd Sunday. A, B, C, those here, always Good Shepherd Sunday. Although this Sunday, we could also call it Lilac Sunday. It was wonderful driving up here, especially between Ontario and Weiser, and see all the lilacs bushes out in full bloom, pink and lavender and white. Oh, it's just glorious. And then the fields are greening out, the farmers out tending the fields. It's a reminder of the abundance that Jesus, the Good Shepherd, promises us. And he came that we all may have life and have it abundantly. And in the Gospel of John, chapter 10, we always on Good Shepherd Sunday get a piece of that whole chapter. And there's lots to love in that. And Jesus talks about what it means to be Good Shepherd. That the Good Shepherd calls his own sheep by name. We are each called by name. And he leads us out to pasture. He goes ahead of us, and we, his sheep, follow him. We know his voice. As I said before, I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. And that as the Good Shepherd, Jesus lays down his life for us. And Jesus knows his own, and his own know him. From our own lesson, we read, "My sheep hear my voice, I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they will never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand." Wow, such promises, such delight. Except within our reading, there's kind of a sticky wicket there. That verse there, that Jesus said to some of the Judeans who were gathered around him, said, "But you do not believe because you do not belong to my sheep." That can be a problem. You think about it, it's like, well, there's sheep who belong to Jesus and sheep who don't, and they're out of luck. And this is something that Christians have struggled with through the centuries, have come up with different answers for. And I found that interesting that two of the Christian Bible scholars that I read about, read their work as I prepare for Sunday sermon, two of them specifically mentioned the difficulty with this particular verse. One of them, her name is Debbie Thomas, and she writes on the website journeywithjesus.net. And I love her essays and reflections because she's very honest about her struggle and times of doubt and how she has, you know, wrestled with things throughout her life. And she's very forthright about her relationship with God. And she writes that she knows what it's like to feel God keeping her in suspense, because that's what these particular Judeans said. "Tell us plainly, are you the Messiah? Why are you keeping us in suspense?" And she has experienced God taking her around about paths, keeping her silent, making her spiritual journey more complicated than she believes it needs to be. Have any of you ever felt that way? Of course. Of course we have. I have. And David Lowe's, who is a Lutheran Bible scholar, pastor, and seminary professor, he also confesses that he experienced something deeply dissatisfying with this exchange between Jesus and his followers. He says, "I grow frustrated as it seems this whole thing is something of a setup. What does Jesus mean that they don't believe because they aren't his sheep? That makes it sound like it's not up to them. Like they couldn't believe if they wanted to. Like those who do believe are just lucky. They're Jesus' sheep. And those who don't aren't." And yeah, that kind of makes you think, is salvation a matter of luck? And where's the grace in this? And where is God's abundant love? Well, one of the things that, that Debbie wrote about in her essay is that, well, perhaps we're putting the cart before the horse. Is it that you have to believe in order to belong? Or in your choice to belong? Then you come to believe, you come to trust in the Good Shepherd, in Jesus. And that trust in Jesus comes from following him, doing what he does, following Jesus through the messiness of life. And goodness sakes, his life was messy. Following Jesus through times of doubt and darkness, and he had those times. Following Jesus through times of frustration. He got frustrated at times with his disciples. Oh Lord, how long must I stay with this generation? And of course that very painful, my God, why have you forsaken me? He knew times of hunger and thirst, and he was homeless while he worked as an itinerant preacher. Now, following Jesus means living in the company of other messy, smelly sheep, listening to his voice in the stuff of day-to-day life. You know, we may not, and we have those times that we don't really understand or know who Jesus is, yet his works, his words draw us to follow him. I know that's true in my life, that, you know, as a young woman, as a teenager, I didn't understand who Jesus was. What did it mean to be the Son of God? Yet, what I read about him in scriptures and the things he said draw me to him. But as I thought and reflected on this, I went back and read the whole chapter, which is a good point, because it's important to take the passages we have in our lectionary in their whole context of that particular, you might say, a literary unit. And actually, the literary unit that this passage belongs in actually begins back in 9, where Jesus heals the man born blind. But back a few verses before the start of our part, it says, Jesus says, I have other sheep that do not belong to me. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. Now, that's kind of been a puzzling one. Like, who are these other sheep? Are they the Gentiles that would come into the church? Are they perhaps intelligent beings somewhere out there that Jesus is going to go and bring into the fold? Well, both of those could be true. But I think there's something even more immediate in the context of the pasture. Because as the Jews who were around him, the Judeans were listening to what Jesus was saying, they said to themselves, you know, hey, some of them are saying he has a demon. Now he's out of his mind. Why listen to him? And others were saying, these aren't the words of a demon. I mean, can a demon heal someone who's been born blind? Jesus says, I have other sheep that do not belong to this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. This is the promise of Jesus. Not just the promise, it's Jesus' imperative to bring those who are not at this moment, who have not come into his fold, who have not chosen to hang out with other Christians, people who seem to be following Jesus, to bring them also into the fold. And his challenge to those Judeans who were saying to him, tell us plainly, are you Messiah? His challenge is, right now, you don't belong to my sheep. It's like you've chosen not to belong to my sheep. Come on, join us in. You will know and understand who I am. I'm not the Messiah you're looking for. See, one of the things in understand this passage, this was a new thing I learned this time around, was that, you know, that Feast of the Dedication? You go, okay, Feast of Dedication. That's just another one of those Jewish feasts. Well, we also know it was winter. The Feast of the Dedication is Hanukkah. And this is the only mention of Hanukkah in the Bible. some of you may recall, Hanukkah is a celebration of Maccabean Jews, led by Judas and his followers. This is Judas Maccabees. They throw out the Greeks, who at that time were occupying that whole crescent of the Middle East. They were occupying Jerusalem and Judea, Galilee, all that area, and they had desecrated the temple, and they had persecuted horribly the Jews who were trying to follow the God faithfully and keep the commandments. So this is a celebration of liberation. And in Jesus' time, now it's the Romans who are occupying Jerusalem. And though the Jews could worship in the temple, there were always Roman soldiers around in case something, you know, a riot broke out or something, or any whiff of revolt, they'd be right there to crush it. So to say, these Jews are saying, are you the Messiah? And they're expecting a political, military Messiah. That was something that was very political, as well as spiritual, but more political. And so, like, these Judeans were looking for a different shepherd than the kind of shepherd Jesus is. And Jesus is trying to tell them, hey, you're going off this way. You're looking for this type of shepherd, and that's going to lead you to death. Which it did. Because eventually the Jews did revolt against Rome, and Jerusalem was destroyed, and the Jews were dispersed. But our shepherd Jesus stays with us and brings others into the flock. And I think of our story of Tabitha Dorcas, which, by the way, Tabitha and Dorcas are transliterations of the Aramaic and Greek name for this wonderful woman. Tabitha Dorcas means gazelle. How pretty, how wonderful. But that Luke gave both of her names is a sign of Luke, again, in his gospel, is the going out to the gospel to the Gentiles and the bringing in of people, like it says in Revelation, of different languages and tribes and nations. This is the kingdom of God. This is what our good shepherd has come to do. And for us as a church is also to go out there and serve those who are different than us. Serve those who are of Hispanic descent here in Jesus. Serve those who are looked down upon, who are regarded as less than and lowly, to seek them out in service. And these days, this is what brings people into the fold. People who are seeking meaning and purpose in their life, and they see Christians and others doing works of service, and they get involved with that, and they begin to know Jesus through that. And it's a beautiful thing. So on this Good Shepherd Sunday, let us rejoice in our Lord Jesus. For we know and we remember those times we have heard his voice, heard him call our name, and in that remembering and sharing that with others, our faith is strengthened, and we grow together in love. The love of God, Jesus, and one another. Amen.
Amen.